Vanakkam. When there is a defect on the hand or a finger and it is too big to allow healing by secondary intention, or too deep to permit a coverage with a skin graft, or too small to plan an abdominal flap cover, the best choice would be a flap from some other part of the hand, like the finger, the palm of the hand, or the dorsum. It is about these intrinsic flaps of the hand that we are going to see in a nutshell in this video and try to understand all about these flaps. Intrinsic flaps in the hand are basically flaps taken from within the region of the hand to cover defects within the region of the hand. Some examples of the intrinsic flaps are the crossfinger flap, the Littler's flap, the FDMA flap, and the Thenard flap. Today, we shall try to understand the intrinsic flaps in the hand based on the Cormack and Lamberti's 6C classification. This basically consists of classification according to the circulation. That is, it could be a random pattern flap or an axial pattern flap. Secondly, the composition of the flap. It could be just a facial flap or a skin flap. It could be a classification based on the contiguity, that is, whether it is local, regional, or microvascular. Flaps based on the construction, whether the blood flow is orthograde or retrograde, and the conditioning of the flap. Some flaps are sensate. And lastly, the conformation of the flap, that is, the changes in design of the flap. We shall see a few examples of each of these patterns of classification. First, the classification based on the circulation, that is, random pattern or axial pattern. A good example of the random pattern flaps are the Attersoy, Cutler, or the Venkateswamy VY advancement flaps. These volar, lateral, and oblique advancement flaps are based on a random blood supply in the subcutaneous tissue, which serves as the pedicle for these advancement flaps. These flaps are typically indicated for fingertip amputations or raw areas. The advantages being they are single stage procedures and they resurface the tips of the finger with glabrous sensate skin, but they have limited advancement. The Cutler's lateral advancement flaps are ideal for transverse amputations of the fingertip, and the volar advancement flap of Attersoy are ideal for dorsal facing oblique amputations. As opposed to the random pattern flaps, the axial pattern flaps are based on axial supply, like the first dorsal metacarpal artery flap, which is based on the first dorsal metacarpal artery, which arises from the radial artery and which supplies the dorsum of the index finger. These flaps are classically indicated for resurfacing defects on the dorsum of the thumb up to the IP joint. The advantage is that this is a sensate flap, but there is a resultant scar on the proximal phalangeal region of the index finger. Hence, this single-staged flap procedure is quite advantageous for resurfacing defects on the dorsum of the thumb. Having understood the different intrinsic flaps based on the circulation, we shall now see the different flaps based on the composition. The flap could be composed of just adipofacial tissue, and the best example for this is the reverse dermis crossfinger flap or the de-epithelialized crossfinger flap, as shown in this example, where first the dermal flap is raised from the donor finger and then the adipofacial flap is raised as a crossfinger flap from the donor finger to resurface the dorsal aspect of the recipient finger and then covered with a skin graft. So the indications are defect on the dorsum of the finger. This procedure, being simple to perform, has the disadvantage that it is a staged procedure and there is a possibility of epidermal inclusion cysts and scarring of the neighboring finger. But the commonest type of intrinsic flap in the hand is a skin flap. The Thenard flap is a good example of the skin flap, which is based on the palmar skin at the base of the thumb. This can be proximally based or distally based, and it brings good glabrous skin cover for the fingertips, which is the best indication for these flaps. But the disadvantages are there may be a painful scar on the donor area on the palm, and there may be interphalangeal joint stiffness if therapy is not started early. This is because of the acute flexion produced in the proximal interphalangeal joint of the recipient finger. But the aesthetic results of this reconstruction are excellent, and the donor scar may sometimes settle well. As far as the contiguity of the intrinsic flap is concerned, which means the nearness of the flap to the defect, it could be a local flap, regional flap, or a microvascular flap. Commonly, there are three types of local flaps: advancement flaps, transposition flaps, and rotation flaps. Since we have already seen the examples of advancement flaps, we shall consider the transposition and rotation flaps now. This is a defect on the volar aspect of the proximal interphalangeal joint crease of the index finger, which has been debrided, and two transposition flaps are planned from proximal and distally based on the ulnar side of the finger. They are raised and flap inset to each other. The secondary raw areas that are characteristic of transposition flaps arise, and these are resurfaced with full thickness palmar skin grafts harvested from the hypothenar area. This is the long-term result. The rotation flap is ideal for dorsal defects where the skin is more lax, and the rotation of the flap can be done at the donor side closed primarily, as shown in this example. Among the intrinsic flaps in the hand, one of the example of regional flap would be the Moschella flap, which is used to cover palmar and radiodorsal soft tissue defects of the thumb, as shown in this example. The movement of an intrinsic flap need not be just by an advancement or as a local flap or as a regional flap, but it can be done as a free flap, as shown in this example of the hypothenar free flap done for resurfacing of a defect caused by amputation of the thumb. The design of the intrinsic flap in the hand based on the direction of blood supply is also interesting. It would be easy to understand this construction pattern based on these four types: type 1 being an orthograde flow, type 2 being a retrograde flow, type 3 a communication from the volar to the dorsal side, and type 4 the flap based on communication from the radial to ulnar side or vice versa. Type 1 refers to the orthograde flow, that is along the direction of principal blood supply in the hand, proximal to distal. Many intrinsic flaps have this orthograde flow, but we shall consider three varied types of flaps: the second dorsal metacarpal artery flap, the lateral digital artery flap, and the staged neurovascular flap. The second dorsal metacarpal artery arises from the radial artery and supplies the skin on the dorsum of the proximal phalangeal region of the middle finger, which can be harvested as a pedicled flap to resurface defects on the dorsum of the index finger, as shown in this clinical example. The lateral digital transposition flap, described in 2009, is also based on orthograde flow in the cutaneous supply from the proper digital artery that supplies up to the distal interphalangeal joint of the fingers from the PIP joint region onwards. This flap is ideal for small defects on the volar aspect of the PIP joints of the fingers arising from tight skin release like dupuytren's or flexor tightness. They are simple flaps for difficult defects, but they have a skin grafted scar on the fingers, and these flaps are slightly bulky. So after release of a tight flexor, multiple defects on the PIP joint region on the volar aspect can be resurfaced with these lateral digital transposition flaps, which yield good results but with a skin graft on the dorsum. The staged neurovascular flap of Professor R. Venkataswamy is another interesting intrinsic flap, which is based on an orthograde blood flow in the proper digital artery that supplies up to the distal interphalangeal joint of the fingers, indicated for reconstruction of transverse thumb amputations at or about the level of the interphalangeal joint. This flap provides sensate skin cover with no sensory re-education required, and less expertise is required for doing the flap. The ulnar side digital nerve of the thumb is tagged. The pedicled flap from the middle finger is inset to this defect on the thumb, and when the flap is divided at the end of 2 weeks, the digital nerve from the midfinger is coapted to the ulnar side digital nerve of the thumb, which had been tagged. The second type of blood flow is the retrograde blood flow, that is, the blood flow is from distal to the proximal of the flaps. Since the blood flow is retrograde, it is prone for venous stasis, Hence, it is necessary to include as many subcutaneous veins as possible in the pedicle. An example of this is the extended reverse dorsal metacarpal artery flap, which is based on retrograde flow from the communication from the volar side vessels at the level of the neck of the metacarpals. These are ideal for defects on the dorsal aspect of the fingers distal to the proximal interphalangeal joint. It's a single stage procedure, but the disadvantage being the donor scars. There are some flaps on the dorsum of the fingers or hand based on blood supply directly through communicating branches from the volar to the dorsal side. As far as the dorsum of the finger is concerned, we all know that there is no proper digital vessel on the dorsal side. However, there is a series of vessel anastomosis based on communications from the proper digital artery on the volar side, and flaps can be raised on these communicating branches. These communicating branches are usually very regular and located at the neck of the middle phalanx, base of the middle phalanx, neck of the proximal phalanx, base of the proximal phalanx, between the heads of the metacarpals and between the necks of the metacarpals. And examples of flaps based on these communicating branches are the reverse dorsal metacarpal artery flap, the Quaba flap, the reverse dorsal digital artery flap or the RDDA flap, and the classical cross finger flap. The reverse dorsal metacarpal artery flap based on communication from the volar side vessels at the level of the neck of the metacarpals for defects on the dorsal aspect of the fingers from the metacarpophalangeal joint distally, as shown in this clinical example, and it has the advantage that it is a single stage procedure. The Quaba flap is based on communication from the bifurcation of the digital artery to the dorsal metacarpal artery at the level of the finger web. It is sometimes known as a commissural artery. It is indicated for defects on the dorsum of the fingers from the PIP joint distally. The flap, when it is raised, it must not cross the wrist crease, and we must be able to close the donor side primarily. This picture shows the defect on the dorsum of the finger, and the Quaba flap has been marked, and the flap has been raised and transferred, and flap has been inset, and this picture shows the post-operative result. Similarly, the reverse dorsal digital artery flap based on communication from the proper digital artery can be raised either as adipofacial flaps or as skin flaps. These flaps are ideal for defects on the dorsal aspect of the fingers from the middle of the proximal pharynx to a little distally. The classical cross finger flap is indicated for coverage of defects on the volar aspect of the middle phalangeal or distal phalangeal regions not extending dorsal to the mid-axial lines, as shown in this example. The next type of classification based on the circulation of the flap is from communication from the radial to the ulnar side of the finger or vice versa. Just like we have communication from the volar to the dorsal side, there are also communications from the radial to the ulnar side at the level of the neck of the middle phalanx, base of the middle phalanx, neck of the proximal phalanx, and base of the proximal phalanx. Flaps can be raised based on the communications at the different levels, and the example of this type of flap is the homodigital island flap, which is based on the communication described previously and hence based on the proper digital artery on the opposite side. This flap can be used for coverage of raw areas on the volar aspect of the finger distal to the proximal interphalangeal joint, as shown in this example of coverage of a defect on the right hand middle finger terminal phalangeal region. The flap marking is shown on the proximal phalangeal region and the well-settled flap is shown here. According to Cormack and Lamberti's classification, flaps can also be conditioned. Example, the flap can be made a sensate flap. The classic example of the intrinsic flap of the hand which is sensate is the Littler's neurovascular island flap, which is based on orthograde flow in the proper digital artery, and it is harvested along with the digital nerve to produce sensibility. It is ideally indicated for defects on the pulp and the tip of the thumb for providing the padding, glabrous skin and sensibility. But we need to remember that sensory re-education is needed so that the patient can appreciate the sensation on the thumb and not on the middle finger, which is the donor finger. And finally, the flap can also be classified based on the changes made to the design of the classical flap. The best example would be the modifications of the cross finger flaps, which are the commonest intrinsic flaps of the hand. And the modifications can be in the design, the technique, or in the donor finger. Modifications in design, like the distally based crossfinger flap or the proximally based crossfinger flap, are quite common. Modifications in technique include the folded crossfinger flap And modifications in the donor finger include the multiple fingers like the double crossfinger flap or the jumping crossfinger flap. To conclude, the main advantages of using the intrinsic flaps for hand reconstruction are simple surgery, easy to execute, safe flaps, and versatility in usage, provided the indications are right. Thank you. I hope you enjoyed the video. I enjoyed making it. Please click on the shown links to see more about different types of flaps, the stepladder abdominal flap, the volar advancement flap on the fingers, and others. And do not forget to subscribe to keep connected with the latest in learning hand surgery.